Your company is acquiring a smaller business, and you've compiled a spreadsheet of the acquired company's last 3 years of sales data. The company wasn't very organized with their records, but you've found everything you need with a bit of digging. The CEO has scheduled a 10-minute chat for an overview of your complied data. With only 10 minutes with the CEO, you can't read the data line by line. Instead, you're going to need to create some sort of summary and likely visualizations to describe the data you've collected. Exactly which summaries and visualizations you choose may influence the conclusions drawn by anyone looking at that data. This is a big responsibility, and we should consider our options carefully. Welcome to the branch of statistics known as descriptive statistics. Descriptive statistics is all about organizing and summarizing data so that we can broadly and quickly describe it. You'll likely recognize some descriptive stats right away. For example, mean, median, and mode are all descriptive statistics that we refer to as measures of central tendency. There are some less commonly used descriptive stats that can offer us different insights, such as variance, standard deviations, skewness, and kurtosis. These can be categorized as either measures of dispersion or shapes of distribution. This chapter will explore these categories of descriptive statistics. We'll also be exploring some real market data in Excel, using some of the tools and functions to pull relevant descriptive statistics quickly. Finally, we'll end with a look at visualizations of data, basic line charts, plot graphs, box and whisker charts, and, in particular, we'll look at what each chart is good at describing or emphasizing about our data. Measures of central tendency attempt to identify the central position of our data. There is the mean, which tells us the average of our data. Median, which tells you the middle number if we arranged our data from the smallest value to the largest. And mode, which describes the most frequently occurring number. Under a normal distribution, the mean, median, and mode should all fall in the middle. But in most other scenarios, these measures are not interchangeable. Each tells us something different about our data, and we may prefer one, depending on what it is we are trying to understand. One of the ways in which these three measures are different is in how sensitive they are to outliers or skewing. As our data skews left or right, the mean moves with that skewing. The median moves as well, but to less of a degree. And our mode remains right at the peak. When the mean, median, and mode are taken together, they can be helpful for understanding the skew of our distribution. We'll come back to talk more about skews later in this chapter. The mean is used a lot in statistics on its own. It is a description that is most meaningful when we have data that is relatively normally distributed without a lot of outliers. In that scenario, we can reasonably expect samples to cluster around the mean. It's a popular measure when looking at company performance, where credit analysts like to look at the last 3 years of a company and form an average to understand how it is doing. It's also used to measure the expected default rates of loans and insurance premiums. Median is useful when we want to diminish the effect of outliers. Imagine a scenario where you are studying the salaries of several companies. If we include owners or high-paid executives, that might skew our measure significantly if we apply an average. Using the median diminishes the influence of top earners and gives us a more realistic sense of the salaries of typical workers in that company. Alternatively, when looking at the distribution of S&P 500 daily returns, there are frequently quite a few outliers. Finally, there is the mode. The mode is best applied when our data set is quite large and a curve is apparent. When applied to small data sets or relatively flat curves, it shouldn't be considered as too meaningful. But with a good set of data, the mode describes the most likely outcome. It's the outcome that occurs the most frequently. A call center trying to figure out the busiest hours of the day, the point when it will perhaps need the most staff, would ideally want to look at the mode. This would be particularly true in a situation where there is a bimodal distribution. In this scenario, both the mean and the median do a poor job of predicting when the restaurant will be busiest, as they land somewhere in the middle of our two humps. The mode would tell us exactly the peak hour. We could even apply a bimodal approach to identify multiple modes: call centers, restaurants, marathon organizers, or any business that deals with seasonality can really benefit by applying the mode in data analysis. Measures of dispersion, or measures of spread, help us understand how dispersed or spread out our data is, which in turn lets us know how meaningful our mean is. Put another way, how far a random result is likely to fall from the mean. If our data is widely spread, a result far from the mean becomes more likely. When making inferences, this can mean more uncertainty. The simplest measures of dispersion are the minimum, maximum, and range, or the smallest value, largest value, and distance between them. The minimum, maximum, and range help us understand the best and worst case scenarios. When looking at a Monte Carlo simulation, the minimum would be the most we are expecting to lose, and the maximum is our greatest expected gain. And the range would describe the entire spectrum of possibilities. Quartiles are another way of dividing distributions. Whereas median is just the middle of our data, quartiles take the middles of that middle, dividing our data set into four quarters. This method is popular with economists who use quartiles to study policy effects at different income levels. By looking at changes in income across the first, second, third, and fourth quartiles, they can provide a more nuanced picture of a changing economy, which speaks to the experiences at each quartile. Variance is a measure of how spread out all our data points are. A high variance suggests a high volatility, while a low variance suggests a low volatility. This measure is quite popular with investors who use it to describe the risk of certain investments. Accountants will also use variance to describe how much a budget item may be expected to swing month to month. By comparing past budgets to actuals, we can quantify the variance of particular budget items. Standard deviation is our last measure of spread. It's very commonly used in statistics. The standard deviation describes the average distance we expect an individual data point or sample to fall from the mean. It is often abbreviated as SD, or the Greek letter sigma. When our data is normally distributed, standard deviation easily helps us understand the likelihood of data falling inside or outside a specific range. This is because 68% of data falls within one standard deviation, 95% of data falls within two standard deviations, and 99.7% of data falls within three standard deviations. This is known as the 68-95-99.7 rule, or the empirical rule. So imagine we had a bucket of gala apples, and we knew that the mean weight of these apples was 200 grams. With a standard deviation of 12 grams, if we pick an apple out of our bucket, that would mean it has a 68% chance of being within 188 and 212 grams. It also means that we have only a 2.5% chance of pulling out an apple that is more than 236 grams. We'll come back to this idea as we get more into inferential statistics. For now, let's take a closer look at how variance and standard deviation are calculated. We're going to run through a couple calculations to help you better understand what variance and standard deviation represent and how they're related. When we need to know these numbers in later activities, we'll use Excel to do the calculations. To calculate the variance, we want to measure the distance of each point in our dataset from our mean. Intuitively, you might then think to add all these distances together and take the average. Let's try that. Here are our data points. We'll take each data point and subtract the mean from it. Next, we'll add those together. We get 0. Okay, so we have an issue. Some of our samples are negative, and some are positive. This is causing our negative and positive samples to just cancel each other out. For that reason, we insert an extra step of squaring each number. Now all our numbers are positive. We'll then take the sum of these numbers and divide by the number of points we have, minus 1. This is our variance, represented by a lowercase sigma squared. Once we've calculated our variance, finding our standard deviation is easy. The standard deviation equals the square root of our variance and is represented by a lowercase sigma. Sometimes it is even referred to as the sigma. Often, you'll see the variance written simply as the standard deviation squared. If we square our standard deviation, we get right back to our variance. We've learned methods for describing the central tendency of our data and the spread of our data. Let's look at ways to describe the shape of our data. Remember this chart of apple weights? These weights are what we call normal distributed, also known as the Gaussian distribution. The normal distribution shows up a lot. Heights, blood pressure, and IQ all follow a normal distribution like our apples did. The key features are that it is symmetrical around the mean. The mean, median, and mode are all the same. And our normal distribution also has tails on both sides, which approach but never touch the x-axis. Finally, by applying the empirical rule to any normal distribution, we can determine the proportion of values that fall into certain ranges of the mean. 68% of our points fall within one standard deviation, 95% within two, and 99.7% within three. We're going to be seeing a lot of the normal distribution. This is because a lot of statistical tests require that our data is normally distributed. This may sound like a big limitation, but it really isn't. We'll explore why in Chapter 3 when we discuss the central limit theorem. Data also comes in distributions that are not normal. It can be bimodal, parabolic, flat, asymmetric, or just about anything. Asymmetric data distributions are common and are often described in terms of skewness. Skewness describes where the data is clumped and where the outliers tend to occur at. With negatively skewed distributions, most of the outliers tend to be on the left of the mean, pointing in the negative direction, while most of the data tends to be clumped to the right of the mean. With positively skewed distributions, the outliers tend to be on the right of the mean, with data clumped on the left. Kurtosis is another description, which focuses on the weight in the tails and around the mean. More or less normal distributions are mesokurtic. In platykurtic, the weight of the distribution is spread around the mean, with very little distribution in the tails. And leptokurtic distributions are more peaked, with very fat tails, and therefore a larger number of outliers as well. While the normal distribution is quite normal, non-normal distributions are also common. In finance, the distribution of asset returns are normally not normal. The S&P 500, for example, tends to be leptokurtic. Real estate, bonds, and commodities and other investments, which rarely swing, tend to be platykurtic.